morning, it's time to begin our service. Any birthdays or anniversaries this past week? Birthday. All right. Get to walk all the way to the front. Any others? Let's stand. We'll sing Happy Birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you. You may be seated. Our pastor is going to come. We're glad to have him back with us. You're going to come and do the welcome. Welcome and announcements. Get your card.
Well, I got my heart right. Well, hold on a minute. Amen. I don't mean spiritually speaking. I've been right a long time, but it's firing on all you. I'm going to tell y'all, I'm going to get on your nerves. I've got to do something. I don't remember how many weeks ago it was that my days have just ran together and in and out of the hospital and everything. But a few Sunday nights ago, my dear church family, you all gathered around us and prayed. And we talked about when the time came that I was feeling better, that we would thank God. And I've got to thank Him this morning. I mean, He's took care of us. He's brought us this far. And there is a lot of times that the devil would say, you're not going to be an effective pastor. You might as well quit. You're not ever going to preach. You're not going to grow old with your wife. You're not going to see your kids grow. He'd tell you all these lies. Well, I've just got news for him. This past Monday, when I had this pine cone put in. Amen. I'm glad I ain't got too much medicine in me today. But I'm thankful. I told the devil just to get on out of my hospital room. He was a liar. Amen. And the father of it. And I'm feeling good. I'm sore, but I'm feeling good. And I can't wait to just keep on preaching the gospel. I love y'all so much. Thank God for you. It wouldn't take too much to preach. Man, but I'm going to try not to testify because you'd be here and you ain't ready for it. So I'm going to try to testify in segments. Thank you, Dad, in segments. Now, so my heart's doing good. I got my eyes on. I can see everybody clearly. It's amazing. And then I've got this hearing or this ringing that's been going on for some time. I put that on the back burner, but hopefully in the next week or so, they're going to get that figured out. So maybe I'll get my hearing aids, got my pacemaker, I got my eyes. Whew, praise God. Amen. So everybody's going to say, come on to First Free Will Baptist Church. Our pastor's 40, but he's more like an 80-year-old. Let me make just a few announcements. Boy, it's good to be here. It's good to see y'all. And I think I'm still trying to get all that sugar out of my system from yesterday. How many seen that cinnamon roll? Praise God. All right, I got to get settled down here. Let me make this one before I forget. Right after preaching, going to open up the doors for membership. Got a dear person that talked to me a couple of weeks ago and going to open up the doors. And so we're excited about that. I appreciate Brother Grady. Appreciate Brother Steve. They've been right on just as soon as we've needed them. They've been ready. And I appreciate these men of God. Let's give them a big hand. Brother Grady is going to be preaching both services today because I didn't know how I was going to be feeling. But I'm going to ag him on real good. I feel good enough to ag him on. And you know what it might be like, Brother Grady? We've talked one time. Brother Jack Lassiter, several years ago, It's been, Brother Phil was the pastor here. Dean family was singing special, and Jack Lasseter was doing revival. And Jackie Cole was sitting on the second row, and Brother Jack Lasseter just got up. He hadn't even opened his Bible yet. And Jackie Cole kept saying, "Come on, Jack, come on, brother, preach. Come on, Jack, come on, brother, preach. Come on, Jack, come on, brother, come on, come on, we're ready, preach." And Jack Lasseter said, "Brother, if you'll shut up, I'll preach." So I might sit down there and say, "Come on, CM, come on, Brother Grady, come on, CM, come on, brother, come on." He might say, "If you'll shut up." I know what you all are thinking right now, shut up. Sister Alicia, I'm trying. I ain't had this much energy since I was like 10. I'm sorry, brother. All right, let me make just a few. Is everybody okay? I'm doing, Sister Brandy, I'm doing the best ever was. All right, if you'd like to help pack shoe boxes, meet here at 5 o'clock today. Oh, I'm just kidding. Putting the boxes together. We ain't packing them yet, but putting the boxes together. Be here at 5 o'clock, all right? If you would like to go to Boone to help do the shoebox ministry, please let Sister Alicia know, okay? And she needs to know pretty soon so we can get the reservations. All right, so get with Sister Alicia. It's important. If you'd like to peel and help cook the apples on Thursday, November the 5th, and Friday, November the 6th, okay? And then we'll be making the apple butter on Saturday, November the 7th. So the 5th, 6th, and the 7th. Next Saturday, we fall back. So you gain an hour. Isn't that wonderful? And you'll gain an hour. We're going to fall back. Remember that next Saturday, and I'll try to remember to make a one call. Tonight, right before preaching, Brother Joel Crisp is going to be here doing some singing. We're looking forward to that. We all love Brother Joel and his humility and the touch of God on his life. All right, how many's happy to be here?
Amen.
How many's glad to be saved?
Amen.
How many's on your way to heaven?
Amen.
How many's ready for me to sit down?
Amen.
All right, now, Dad, I love you, buddy. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be here. I just want to thank you. I just want to praise you. Thank you, Lord, for touching me. Thank you for helping me. Lord, I owe it all to you. I thank you for Dr. Siv, Lord, that he found out what was going on. Lord, I believe you guided him and directed him. He was such a help to me. And then, Lord, thank you for all them nurses that come in and testify and talk to me about Jesus. And I got to talk to them about Jesus, and they'd testify, and I'd testify. We had just had a big old time there in the hospital. Lord, I thank you for all the physicians and everybody that I met, and even Miss Vicki Bowers that'd come in every day and bring me in, before she'd clean the room, bring me in an encouraging card. Meant so much to me. I want to thank you for Mama that's helped me, and my wife that's helped me, and Dawn's done so much, even just helping me bathe and all that. And Lord, I don't take it lightly. I thank you for a good helpmeet that you gave me 20 years ago. I love her. Thank you for my kids. Thank you for my church family. All the text messages, the phone calls, the cards. Lord, I love them. I want to be here with them till the rapture of the church. I hope they can put up with me. And Lord, I love them. I pray, Father, for the service, the singing. I pray the church sings like they ain't never sung. I want us to worship like we ain't never worshiped. Lord, I pray that you preach Brother Grady. Lord, I can't wait to hear what you've given him. I thank you for him and Brother Steve and Brother Bill and Brother Mark, all these preachers, Lord, that's just always ready to give us a help, and that means a lot. Lord, I love you. We all love you. We know you love us. Father, be with us now. We'll give you praise and glory. All the thanksgiving goes to you. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we give him a hand clap of praise? All right, Brother C.M., you're my buddy. I love you. Amen.
All right, let's stand. We'll sing all three verses of Blessed Be the Name. First, second, and last verse of At the Cross. the deacon's prayer this morning, so Sister Angie's going to come and sing for us at this time.
I remember how it felt when I heard about the cross, and I was thinking to myself, how could I be worth that great of cost? And as the story was unfolding, I heard a voice like I had never known. That's when mercy called my name. That's when love broke every chain. When his blood covered my sin and my life began changing, grace became amazing. I have walked so many miles, I'm no stranger to the way, but I'm learning through each trial. Healing cannot come without the pain. And on the days I feel defeated, God takes me back to one day long ago. That's when mercy called my name. Lost, my soul was found. When my strength was running out, that's when mercy called my name. That's when love broke every chain. When his blood covered my sin and my life began changing. Yes, my life began changing, and grace became amazing.
Two Sunday nights ago, I preached from Romans, and Brother Steve's been in Romans, and so I guess we're just going to stay in Romans for a little while. I guess that's all right, because that's where the Lord's leading. Amen. Romans chapter 3, verse 9, 10, 11, 12. What then? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Brother Tom, would you lead us in prayer, please? Amen. You may be seated. In the first three chapters of Romans, Paul explains why the world needs a Savior. And I guess the best verse that we can look at is Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And if you go back to that text verse, the word all and none is mentioned several times. But Paul divided the world of men into three different categories in his day. And it's the same in our day. The first was the atheist, those that reject God outright. They say there is no God. And I just thought about this morning, if you got up in time to see the sunrise and you look at the mountains and the color of the trees, yes, and you feel the cool air and you see the sunset, how could you not believe that there's a God? I mean, just nature tells us that there's a God in heaven. And some folks say, well, it was a Big Bang Theory. And I believe that because the Lord spoke it and bang, it happened. That's the way it went. You know, there's no way you can tell me that there's some explosion in outer space and everything just fell into place where it's supposed to go. But these folks did not believe in God. And I've said this before, if you ever come face to face with an atheist and talk to them, you can say, well, I'm going to live my Christian life, and if I'm wrong, I've lost a lifetime. But if I'm right and God is in control, you've lost eternity. So there are those atheists that don't believe that there is a God. And then there's the moral people, moralist, good moral type, self-righteous folks. And there's a lot of folks around that are good to their family. They work, they supply for their family, they do a lot of things in the community. Sometimes they even come to church occasionally. But and they never get in trouble with the law or anything like that. They're just good moral folks. And sometimes those folks are hard to witness to, because you talk to them and they're like the fella in the Bible that talked about, you know, I've built my barns and I've got so much crop coming in, I'm going to have to build bigger barns. And sometimes folks are like that. You know, I've supplied for my family and we live in a nice house, got nice vehicles. The family's doing well. We don't have any sickness or anything. Why do I need God? Well, for one thing, you need to miss hell. Yeah. And we do need God in that situation. And then the third type is, and Paul talked about this, the religious group. And some of those folks in Paul's day were saying, well, our father's Abraham, and it carried on down to us. Well, that's right, it did. And they are God's chosen people. But, you know, even the Jew has to acknowledge the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. And I know I've said this before, and it's been said so many times, but I still think it's worth repeating, and that is, just because your grandparents or your parents brought you to church all the time does not make you a Christian. Amen. Might make you a better person, but it does not make you a Christian. There has to be that one-on-one confrontation with the Lord Jesus Christ that you come to know Him as your personal Savior. And I've heard it said this way. It's sort of an odd illustration, I guess, but coming to church won't make you a Christian any more than sleeping in your garage tonight will make you an automobile. That's sort of a stupid thing to say, I guess, but it's a true thing to say. But Paul lumps all of these together into either Jew or Gentile. The Jews are lost. Jesus came to the Jews. They rejected Him. And then it was opened up to us as Gentiles. And I'm thankful for that, because not only is the Jew lost, but the Gentiles are lost. And then, of course, in verses 9 through 12, he tells us that there's none righteous. Not one of us are righteous. Our righteousness is filthy rags, Isaiah tells us. But our goodness, no good. And there's so many people nowadays, I'm afraid, that they say, well, when I stand before Jesus Christ as my judge, there's going to be scales. And my good deeds are going to be over here, and my bad deeds are going to be over here. And if my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds, then I'm going to get into heaven. No, that's not the situation, friend. It's going to be a one-on-one encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. The title of the message, Salvation for All, the first point is universal sin. In Romans chapter 3, verses 9 through 23, I want to look at those. And I read 9 through 12 as the text verses this morning. But notice the word none and all. When you talk about there's none that doeth good, that means there's not anybody. None of us do good. And when it says all have sinned, or we're all gone out of the way, or we're all unprofitable, that means all of us. Doesn't matter who we are. Doesn't matter what standing we have in the church. Doesn't matter what standing we have in the neighborhood or in the state or in the county or in the nation, as far as that goes. Because the Bible says we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. In verses 9 through 12, in verse 11, he says there's none that understandeth. That deals with our mind. In verse 11, he also says there's none that seeketh after God. That deals with our heart. And in verse 12, he says, there's none that doeth good. And that talks about our will. And so the entire man needs to know the Lord Jesus Christ. In our mind, our heart, and in our will, we turn over to Him to be saved. In verses 13 through 18, Paul gives us a little study of the sinner from head to foot. Talks about his throat, his lips, his mouth, his feet, and his eyes. And in verse 13, the first part of that verse says, their throat is an open sepulcher. How many folks have you heard speak that really don't know how to speak? And I'm not talking about the English language like we try to speak from the pulpit. Sometimes we mess up. But I'm talking about just filthy, sorry language. And to me, a person's just telling me that they don't have any IQ whatsoever. If they have to use the Lord's name in vain, they have to use filthy words, and they have to use dirty words to fill in every sentence. It just shows me a lack of IQ on their part, a lack of vocabulary on their part. And so Paul says their throat is an open sepulcher, and of course Paul was a very brilliant man. He was a learned man, and if you'll go back to Psalm chapter 5, verse 9, you'll find this quotation from there. And then on down in verse 13, he says, with their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asp is under their lips. Back in Psalm chapter 140, verse 3, the psalmist talks about this particular thing. And in verse 14, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. And that's found in Psalm chapter 10, verse 7. Paul was giving them this dialogue here, but he was quoting from the Old Testament where it had already been written down, and he had learned from that. And then verses 15 through 17, their feet are swift to shed blood, destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. Talks about their feet. Isaiah 59, verse 7 and 8. Talk about almost identically these verses right here. And I thought about the shape our country's in right now. These peaceful protesters that have been protesting in cities for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks, and nothing's been done about it. Their feet are swift to shed blood. How many people, how many police officers, how many folks have been killed by these folks? Why? They don't fear God. They don't care about God. And then the second part of that, destruction and misery are in their ways. What have they done? Burned buildings down, tore things down, injured people, torn up vehicles, the whole shooting works. And in verse 17, in the way of peace, have they not known? And you know, I get upset, and I try not to get angry, but I get upset when I see those things on TV. Those folks are just foolish. I mean, it's just crazy the way the world is today. But you know, they need the peace of God in their heart. They need to know the Lord Jesus Christ. And we need to pray for them. Sometimes it may be hard for us to say, well, I need to pray for somebody that just killed somebody out there and they're not going to be punished for it. But we need to pray for them. We need to pray for our nation. We need to pray for these folks because they are under the leadership of Satan himself. Verses 13 and 14 talks about human speech. There is a connection between words and between character. Your words will tell other folks what you believe and how you believe and how you live and how you want to live. Matthew chapter 12 verse 34 says, "For out of the heart the mouth speaketh." And I know sometimes we slip and say something maybe we shouldn't, but when we're continually saying something that we shouldn't or degrading other people or talking down on other people, that comes from the heart, and we need to get our heart right with God. And then Matthew 12:37 says, "For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words shalt thou be condemned." If our words are sweet, the Holy Spirit's guiding our words from our heart, then we're going to be justified. But if Satan is ruling in our heart, in our mind, and in our life, and our words are going to be to damnation for us if we don't change our ways. And in verse 15 and 16, Paul pictures the sinner's feet. And just as words are deceitful, so the sinner's way is destructive. He doesn't do anything good because he's away from God. Ephesians chapter 6, Paul tells us the Christian's feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. We've talked about, Brother Steve and I both, when we filled in, we've talked about love, we've talked about peace, we've talked about grace, we've talked about mercy. And those things are needed in our lives today, in our nation today. And verse 17 deals with the sinner's mind and the way of peace have they not known. And I covered this a couple of weeks ago. I think I even used this verse, Romans 5:1. "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." How can anyone have peace? Suppose that the preacher was not a preacher and his family was not saved. And they just went through several weeks or months of what they've gone through. How would they deal with that if they didn't have their faith and their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ? Knowing folks were praying for them, knowing folks were there if they needed them. I mean, how do folks get along without knowing Jesus Christ as their Savior? And in verse 18, talks about the sinner's pride. There is no fear of God before their eyes. And I thought about the placard that the one fellow had at one of the peaceful protests. Said, "If Jesus comes back, we'll kill him again." Nope. He came once for that. The next time it'll be different. Because he'll come back as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And we'll be with him. And I'm glad that he's going to come back, but we still need to pray for those folks that are blinded by Satan. And I could not imagine even carrying a sign or being with someone that had a sign that said that. I can't even imagine that. Verse 18 talks about the sinner. Proverbs 1:7 says this, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." If you want to be a smart person, turn to God. Start working for Him, reading, learning from Him. As long as we defend ourselves and compare ourselves to others, then we'll probably never need to see the need of a Savior. Because a person has to realize they're lost before they can come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. And I know the pastor has, I think he's probably said this before. If you read the obituary for folks in Carter County and the surrounding areas, everybody's saved. You know, there's nobody lost. And I don't know how that comes about when you see the life of some of the people that they're talking about. Maybe they went to church when they were little. Maybe they made some kind of decision, but there's no life to show for serving Jesus Christ. And so we need to have folks that realize that they're lost, and then when the Holy Spirit deals with their heart, we can maybe witness to them and they can come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Universal sin, all are under sin, and there's none of us that are going to escape it. And then universal salvation in Romans chapter 5, and I covered this a couple of weeks ago on Sunday night, and I'm just going to hit the highlights of it. Verse 15 contrasts Adam's offense, the first Adam, with Christ, the second Adam. Verse 16, the effect of Adam's sin is contrasted with Christ's obedience on his death to the cross. Verse 17, the two reigns. Either you reign with the first Adam, Satan controls your life, or you're with the second Adam, Jesus Christ, and he controls your life. And the two one acts are contrasted in verse 18 and verse 19. The first Adam had one act, sin, brought death, destruction to us as people, human beings here on this earth. But then the one act of Jesus Christ of laying down his life and dying on the cross of Calvary gave us victory over that first Adam, gave us victory over that sin and victory over that death that was passed to us. And in verse 20 and 21, law and grace were contrasted by Paul here. And he said the law was brought about so that you would know your sin. And then grace is what the Lord gave us to take care of that sin. And I read this somewhere. I don't know where it was, but I wrote it down. I cannot give credit to whoever wrote it. You cannot help being in Adam, the first Adam, but you don't have to stay in Adam. We have to live in this world, and it's a hard job to live in this world and put up with some of the folks that you have to put up with, especially if you work in the public any at all. But you know, it's just like a ship. It's made to float on the water. What happens when the water gets in the ship? It sinks. We're in this world, but the world doesn't need to be in us, because if it gets in us, then we're going to be going farther and farther away from God, and we need to be drawing closer and closer to Him. Universal sin and universal salvation, those 2 points, for those that might be here that don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you've never given your heart and life to Him. You don't know that there's a definite time that you've said, yes, I know the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe you're watching via live stream or Facebook. You can make that decision this morning by simply saying, Lord, I believe that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross and to shed His blood, and I want to accept Him into my heart and let Him be my Savior. Amen. You can do that this morning. The third point is universal sanctification. Romans chapter 6, verse 1 through 23 talks about the sanctification. Paul defended his doctrine, but he anticipated 3 objections. We covered 1 2 weeks ago. It says, if God's grace abounds when we sin, then let's continue sinning so we might experience more grace. Now that sounds sort of crazy, doesn't it? If we sin, God's grace is coming to us. So therefore, let's just sin more and more and more and more so we can get more and more and more and more grace. No, not when we're a new creature, Paul tells us. Old things have passed away, behold, all things become new, so therefore you put sin away, and the grace is going to be there. Number 2, we're no longer under the law, then we're free to live as we please. And this is called liberty. Once I've been saved, no longer under the law, so I'm free to live just however I want to live. I mean, you know, if you're going to come over to my house and visit and you don't believe it's right to eat meat offered to idols and I buy it at the supermarket because it's half price, I don't serve it to you because that's wrong. That's, you don't believe that that's what you need to do, and it doesn't bother me, but I don't need to serve it to you. I don't need to say it around you. I don't need to be that around you. In other words, do not do something purposely that would hurt someone else because of what they believe. There's core beliefs in the Bible that we believe, and as long as someone believes those core beliefs, I can fellowship with them, I can work with them. That's not a problem. But there's some things that we have as personal things in our life. And if you know somebody that has something that they believe, you don't need to just go up and throw it up in their face. As long as they're believing the core beliefs, you can fellowship with them and work with them and do that. But we don't have just liberty to live any way we please, Paul says. And then you've made God's law sinful is the third thing that the objection that Paul was going to face. The law was showing our sin, but it was not sinful within itself. But Paul gives us three instructions for obtaining victory over sin, and that's once we're saved. Sanctification, of course, is an ongoing process. We become more and more and more and more like Jesus Christ. And so how do we obtain victory over sin? There's three things in verse 6. In verse 3, it says, "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death." Verse 6, "Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and henceforth we should not serve sin." And then verse 9, "Knowing that Christ being raised from the dead dieth no more, death hath no more dominion over him." And as I said just a second ago, Paul said in 2 Corinthians, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature or new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." We need to know this, knowing sinners in our mind. We need to know that that we're living for Jesus Christ. And we need to know that Christ is in control of our life. And we need to know that those old things are passed away. Those things are gone. Those sins are forgotten and forgiven. And we need to live for the Lord Jesus Christ because all things are becoming new as we live for him. And in verse 11, an old word, "Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord." And to reckon simply means to put to one's account. What's been put to our account? We owed a debt we could not pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. The blood of Jesus Christ has been put to our account. And we need to realize that our sins are forgiven. And I think reckon simply means this: to believe that what God says in his word is true. And not only is it true in here, but it's true in our life. And he, as long as we follow him, he controls our life and we can live for him. We don't fully understand it. I don't know of anyone that fully understands the Word of God, but we believe it, we trust it, and we try to follow it, and we claim it for ourselves. Not only knowing in our mind, but reckon has to do with your heart because we're presenting ourselves to him. And then yield, the word yield is found five times in the section that we're talking about here. And it means to place at one's disposal, to present, and to offer as a sacrifice. So how do we yield ourselves to God? Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and verse 2, I think, give us the very simple answer. "I beseech you therefore, brethren," Paul says, "I beg you therefore, my Christian brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice." And that's sort of odd because in the Old Testament, when you had a sacrifice, you had to kill an animal before you sacrificed it. So I can imagine that some of the folks asked Paul, how do you have a living sacrifice? He said, because I'm dead to sin, but I'm alive through the Lord Jesus Christ. So therefore, you can have a living sacrifice. Not only that, but holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And I know it's been said many, many times before, but if Jesus Christ was willing to die on the cross and shed his blood for us, then what is our reasonable service? Just to live for him and to promote his gospel. And then verse 13, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. How do we renew our mind? We read the Bible, we pray, we fellowship one with another, and we worship together as a group, worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. No sinners in the mind, reckon on the heart, and yield touches the will of man. So all of man needs to be given over to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I wanted to touch on this sanctification because we need to know that we've been crucified with Christ and we're dead to sin. We need to know that in our hearts, not just in our minds, but in our hearts. And we need to prove it in our lives. And I want to close with this illustration. There's so many times I think that we maybe try to compare ourselves to someone else. Say, well, I go to church more than they do, or I do more in church than they do, or I do this, or I do that. That's not going to work because we don't compare ourselves to each other. And let me give you this little illustration. If you take 50 pianos in a concert room and you have a fellow that's going to tune them and he has a tuning fork and he goes around and he tunes the first piano and then he lays his tuning fork down and he tunes piano number two to number one and he tunes number three to number two and number four to number three until he gets to all 50 of them. They're tuned to each other. And then you start playing them and it sounds terrible because they're not in tune. But you take the same fellow with the one tuning fork and he tunes every piano with the same tuning fork. And all 50 pianos start to play and they sound great. That should tell us something. We don't tune ourselves to somebody else. We tune ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we get to where we can follow him and be like him more and more every day, then we're going to be the Christian we need to be. As the ladies come and play maybe a verse of Just As I Am, let's stand, bow our heads. Maybe you're here this morning, and like I said, the first part of this message was for the person that was maybe lost, don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Maybe you're watching via internet some way or Facebook or YouTube and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. This is a time that you could come to know Him and turn your life around and quit letting Satan control and guide your life and let the Lord Jesus Christ do that. Maybe you're here this morning as a Christian and you say, I've got problems. I need to be closer to the Lord. I need to know more about Him. In sanctification, we become more and more and more and more and more like Him. And so maybe you have some problems. Maybe you have a need. Maybe you just want to pray and thank Him for what He's done during this time. Whatever that need is, the altar's open as they begin to play. If you need to come, please come. As they play, any others? We'll stand quietly while they're still here at the altar.
I appreciate the good preaching, don't you?